Savior. So the purpose of the Ten Commandments is to show you your sin so that you run to Jesus for salvation. Nevertheless, the Ten Commandments are your friends. Keep them and you'll be much more blessed in life. Break them and no, you don't break them. They'll break you. Now, let me just close by telling you what I thought of. My dad was a Catholic and he went to church every Sunday. But growing up in my house, my dad kept boxes of pornography in the garage. I found that stuff when I was 10 years old. Talk about how to mess up your kids. Well, I think my brother found it too, anyway. When I was 18 years old, my dad was told, "You have a brain tumor, you won't live for a year." And immediately, all the pornography was out of the house. And Dad lived a little over a year. But I think my dad saw a connection between his pornography and his brain tumor. And here's my final point to you. The Ten Commandments are your friends. The most important one is to don't let any other gods in your life. Make sure God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is number one in your life. And pornography, alcohol, entertainment, hobbies, sports, whatever you're letting be number one in your life, push it off the throne so God doesn't have to do something drastic to you to get your attention that He needs to be God and nothing else in your life. I want to close by asking you to do something this week. Would you do one of these three things? Let me put them on the screen. Here we go. Number one, would you do this for 7 mornings? Next 7 mornings, pray, "God, control my tongue today." Or would you do number two? Next time you're tempted to be jealous or covet what somebody else has, stop then and say, "God, thank you you've given that to that person, but thank you for giving me," and then fill in the blank. Or would you do number three? If you are not tithing, if you're not giving 10% of your money to the work of the Lord, start doing it and see if God, Malachi 3, doesn't open the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing. Those are the Ten Commandments. I encourage you to pray in the morning for your tongue. Start giving 10% to the Lord. And number three, when you're tempted to be jealous, thank God for something. Amen.
Welcome to the portion of the Pastor's Study where we now ask Pastor Brock to share with us his knowledge of Scripture and his insights to answer questions we have regarding the Bible, our Lord, and our everyday walk with Him. Pastor Brock, you've just gotten done talking about the Ten Commandments. Is there anyone that can live without breaking the commandments?
No. I mean, Jackie, I remember meeting a guy at a Bible camp, old man, and he went to a holiness church. And I don't doubt that they're Christian people, but he told me he hadn't sinned for years. And I said, "Look, if I go for 5 minutes without sinning in thought, word, and deed, I think I'm doing pretty good. What do you mean you haven't sinned for years?" And he had kind of redefined sin. And Jackie, you know, you've never killed anybody probably, but Jesus said if you've ever hated someone, in your heart you've killed them. And actually that's in one of the epistles. So in thought, word, or deed, we regularly sin. So I mean, the only one who never has, of course, is Christ Himself. He lived the perfect life that we couldn't. But other than Jesus, even the greatest saints have known themselves to be the greatest sinners.
Now, well, that makes you feel a little bit better.
Yeah.
Pastor Brock, our next question for you is regarding a scripture verse. It's Matthew 7, 21 to 23.
Okay.
It's where Jesus says that these people cast out demons and do miracles in His name, but they're not really Christians. How can this be?
Yeah. You know, let me just read it carefully here. Matthew 7, verse 21 says, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, 'Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, cast out demons in your name, perform miracles in your name?' I will declare to them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness.'" So here's people who healed people in Jesus' name, cast demons out of people in Jesus' name, and they're not going to heaven. Why? Because Jesus says they're workers of lawlessness. You know, God can use atheists to do miracles. But if you've never repented of your sin, not that you're perfect, again, we sin in thought, word, and deed daily, But if you never repent of your sin, you're not fighting your sin, you're a worker of lawlessness, even if you go to church regularly and cast demons out of people, according to this, you're not saved.
But how does God do good through somebody who's evil?
Well, Jackie, when I was thinking of being a pastor many years ago, I went to my pastor in Omaha and I said, I think the Lord is telling me to be a pastor, but who am I to preach the gospel? And he said, Tom, if God could speak through Balaam's donkey in the Old Testament, he can speak through you. And Jackie, Cyrus was a pagan Persian king, and God used him to get the Jews back to the Promised Land. Caesar Augustus was a pagan Roman emperor. God used the decree of Caesar Augustus to get Joseph and Mary into Bethlehem on time to fulfill the Old Testament that Jesus would be born in Bethlehem. So God can use unbelievers. But the question here is, here's people that say they're Christians and do stuff, but they still go to hell. And there are false teachers in the church. I'll give you an example. A very notorious heretic is John Shelby Spong, retired, thank goodness, bishop of the Episcopal Church in New Jersey. And he goes around the country preaching that he doesn't believe in the Trinity. He doesn't believe Jesus' death is the atonement for our sins. He doesn't believe Jesus physically rose from the dead. I mean, you name it, he doesn't believe it. But he says he's a Christian because I believe in the compassion of Christ. Well, what does that mean? I mean, atheists believe in being compassionate. So just because somebody is a bishop or a pastor or says they're a Christian, and even if they do miraculous things, if they're disobedient in thought, word, and deed to the scriptures, you got to wonder, are they saved? And, we all sin, but do you fight your sin? Do you repent when you sin? Or do you live in impenitent sin? If you're living in it, according to Jesus, I think Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 and 20 to 23, they're very sobering. They show us mm-hmm. that we need not to just say we believe, we need to truly believe and live it.
It makes it very hard, though, to understand why these things are happening for people who are maybe new to Christianity and mm-hmm. that.
Well, I know. When you look at some of the TV preachers, Jackie, I mean, I just turned on the TV this morning and saw two TV preachers. You believe, God's going to give you a blessing. You send money to this ministry, you're going to reap your... I'm thinking, Lord, please put people on TV that'll preach the gospel.
Well, our next question is also about another verse in the Bible, Pastor Tom. Mm-hmm. It's Exodus 24:10, where it says, Moses and Aaron saw God. But in John 1:18, it says, no one has ever seen God. So is the Bible contradicting itself here, or is this one of these strange things that we've talked about?
How do you put it together? Because it does say in Exodus 24, Moses and Aaron saw God. But then it says in John chapter 1, no one has ever seen God. So what's going on here? I think there's kind of an easy way to reconcile this one. What John chapter 1 means, no one has seen God in his fullness. They've gotten glimpses of God. But even in Exodus, if you remember, God says chapter 33, God appears again to Moses, and God says, Moses, I'll show you my back, but no one can see my face and live. So even in Exodus, it's admitting there's a sense in which you can see God, and there's another sense in which you cannot see God if you want to live. So I think that's the way to put it together.
Well, and you have people who say they've seen Jesus, mm-hmm. and Jesus is God, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So, I mean, are those people just a vision of things to come?
There are people. I had a lady tell me that she actually had Jesus appear to her in her bedroom. And was that real or not? I don't know, but let's say it was. But she did not see Jesus in his fullness. It would have been a vision of him. We won't see Jesus in his fullness until the second coming.
Okay.
Yeah.
Another section of scripture that's got people confused is in Mark 2:18, and it's when Jesus. What does Jesus mean about not putting new wine into old wineskins?
Yep. This is Mark chapter 2, and let me just read this. Mark chapter 2, 18, where it says, now John the Baptist's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting. And people came and said to Jesus, why do John the Baptist's disciples and the disciples of the Pharisees fast? Your disciples don't fast. And no one puts new, and then Jesus answers this, No one puts new wine into old wineskins. If he does, the wine will burst the skins, and the wine is destroyed, and so are the skins. New wine is for fresh wineskins. I didn't know this, but you know, if you put new wine into old wineskins, it bursts them. So you have to put new wine into new wineskins. And the Pharisees are trying to say, and these people are saying, why don't you do everything just like John the Baptist did? Why don't you do everything just like the Pharisees? And Jesus says, something new is happening with my visit to this planet. You can't force me into the mold of John the Baptist. You can't force me into the mold of the Pharisees. I'm doing something new. That's what he meant by the wineskin stuff. And I think the lesson for our lives is, Jackie, it's not a sin to sing a song that's not 500 years old. I love contemporary Christian worship. I love the old hymns too. I like them both. But if you remember, many years ago when we had the contemporary service at our church, it was World War III because those aren't Lutheran hymns. Well, so? You know, nothing's wrong with doing something new in the church. It is wrong if what you do new is unbiblical. But, you know, we need to be careful what we get upset about and let God do new things.
Well, was Jesus teaching and using this as an example? I mean, Jesus told parables,
yes,
where there was contradictions and things.
Yeah.
Is this considered in that same category?
It's kind of a parable. You don't put old wine into new wineskins or they'll burst. So you need to put new wine into new wineskins. His point being, let God do something new. We don't, you know, the famous last words of the church, we never did it that way before. That's the sign of a dying church.
Yeah. Okay, so it is a teaching tool that he was using at the time.
It's a metaphor, if you will.
All right. Mm-hmm. Okay. Someone I know was told by her pastor that she couldn't take communion because she's living with her boyfriend. But doesn't the Bible tell us to judge not, lest we be judged?
I think the most misquoted verse in the whole Bible is, judge not, lest ye be judged. And people that are sinning love to quote that verse because, don't judge me. Jesus said, don't judge, so you can't tell me it's wrong to live with my boyfriend. And my response to that is, in the very same chapter where Jesus says, don't judge, he says, you will know them by their fruits. A good tree does not produce bad fruit. And he's telling us to be fruit inspectors. So, Jackie, what judge not means is, don't think you're better than anybody. Realize you're a sinner who deserves hell too. So we're all humble. We're all in need of salvation. That's what judge not means. Don't think you're superior. But elsewhere in the Bible, it says we are to judge those inside the church. 1 Corinthians 5, Paul says, there's a guy that was sleeping with his stepmother. Paul says, get that guy out of the church.
Yeah. Well, thanks for being with us this week. We pray that God would be with you, granting you his richest blessings until we're together again next time.
As we seek to spread the good news of salvation through Jesus Christ. And would you pray about supporting this ministry? Our address is The Pastor Study, 5200 Emerson Avenue North, Minneapolis, Minnesota, 55430. Our website is pastorstudy.org. And our phone number is 763-260-4484. May God richly bless you, and join us next week at the same time as we study God's Word. Until then, may the blessing of our one triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you.